Let us take a prayerful posture and let us pray. Lord, unveil to us the beauty and the greatness of the immaculate soul and body of the Blessed Virgin Mary. Dear friends, let us offer this hour in praise of God for all the mercy shown to Mary and through her unto each one of us, especially during these days of our Mantle retreat. Our Blessed Mother died of love and great longing, and her body was assumed into heaven. The Catechism of the Catholic Church in 966 says, "The Assumption of the Blessed Virgin is a singular participation in her Son's resurrection and an anticipation of the resurrection of all Christians. In giving birth, you kept your virginity. In your Dormition, you did not leave the world, O Mother of God, but were joined to the source of life. You conceived the living God, and by your prayers will deliver our souls from death." Let us listen to the personal experience of Dr. Hanscott, a Protestant theologian turned Catholic.
I remember the first feast of the Assumption of Mary that I ever experienced over a quarter of a century ago. The night before, I was with a friend of mine named Bill, who was still a Protestant, a Baptist, and really disturbed that I had become a Catholic. And so he brought up the subject of the Blessed Virgin Mary and the Assumption in particular. And so I began to share with him what I had found in the Bible and what I'd found in the Fathers. And it wasn't proof texting. You know, the church never just simply goes to a text and says, that's the proof. It always reads the scripture in its context. So that you're looking at the new in light of the old and the old in light of the new. And so I introduced that interpretive principle to Bill and said, so if you look at the old in light of the new and the new in light of the old, you can see how Jesus himself is presented as a new Adam. Going back to creation. And you can see him as a new Moses going back to the Exodus, bringing about a new Passover. You can see that he's a new Solomon, the son of David, bringing about a new Jerusalem and the kingdom. And then I pointed out that back in creation, it wasn't just Adam, it was also Eve. Back at the time of the Exodus, it wasn't just Moses, it was the Ark of the Covenant as the sign of God's presence. And likewise, at the time of David's kingdom, it wasn't just Solomon you see in 1 Kings 2, verse 19. It was the Queen Mother enthroned at the king's right hand. And so I began to unpack all of this in terms of how the New Testament develops it. So, for example, you go to the Gospel of Luke, chapter 1, and there, even Protestant biblical scholars acknowledge that Luke is presenting the visitation in terms of Mary is coming to the Judean hill country precisely as the Ark of the Covenant was brought up from the Judean hill country in 1 Chronicles 15. And you can hear the language that Luke is using to kind of show that Mary is the Ark of the New Covenant, containing the Word of God, not in stone like the Ark of the Old, but the Word made flesh, you know, containing the hidden manna, but this is the true manna. And so I was trying to explain all of this and show that, you know, in the New Testament book of Revelation, chapter 11, verse 19, you know, John describes this vision that he has of the temple up in heaven being opened and the Ark of the Covenant being seen. And of course, the Ark had gone missing for nearly five centuries. And so for John to tell his readers that he saw the Ark of the Covenant, the Ark of God's Covenant in the Temple of Heaven, this would have been delightful and shocking news. But instead of going on to describe a box covered with gold containing, you know, the stone tablets of God's Word or the hidden manna, he goes on in the next verse or two to describe a woman clothed with the sun, the moon under her feet, crowned with 12 stars. And I suspect that John's readers would have said, you know, go back to the Ark. We haven't seen it in hundreds of years. But instead, you know, he is describing this woman. And, you know, at first glance, you might say, well, he's just changed the subject in a somewhat unexpected way. But of course, he's not describing the Ark of the Old Covenant in the earthly Jerusalem. He's describing the Ark of the New Covenant in the heavenly Jerusalem. So he really didn't shift subjects when he said, I saw the Ark of God's Covenant in heaven, and then a woman clothed with the sun, the moon under her feet, crowned with 12 stars, giving birth to a male child who's destined to rule the nations. In my conversation with Bill, I showed him how there were multiple layers of the Old Testament typology, that you have a kind of new creation because she is the woman of Genesis 3:15, clothed with the sun. You also have a new Exodus image there too, because you've got the Ark of the Covenant, but you've also got the new kingdom imagery, because not only is she giving birth to the male child destined to rule the nations with a rod of iron straight from the Davidic covenant in Psalm 2 describing the Davidic king, but you also have the queen mother, you know, giving birth to the royal child, as it were. And so if you can see how all three are, in a certain sense, converging, how all three are sort of coordinated, you can recognize that the New Testament reading of the fulfillment by Christ of the old involves Mary, who is the new Eve, who is the Ark of the New Covenant, who is, in a way, the Queen Mother as well. And he was intrigued by the argument, you know, but he wasn't bowled over. Well, the next morning, I realized it was August 15th. And so I asked Bill, you know, where is there a parish in town? I've got to get to church. This is a holy day of obligation. And he mentioned that the only parish he knew of was Our Lady of Victory, which was music to my ears, you know. So I asked him for directions, and it got more complicated. He said, look, I'll just drive you. And so he did. And in fact, at the last minute, he decided to come in and experience the Mass for the very first time in his life. And what was so surprising to him and to me was that the first reading was taken from the Old Testament, of course. It was dealing with David carrying the Ark of the Covenant up into the royal capital of the earthly Jerusalem. And then you have a psalm, Psalm 132, I believe it was, that celebrates the Ark of the Covenant being carried by David up into the royal capital of the earthly Jerusalem. In fact, it's the only psalm devoted to the Ark of the Covenant. And then the New Testament reading from Revelation 11 and 12 identifies the Ark of the New Covenant as the woman who is now being taken up into the heavenly Jerusalem. And then we all stood for the gospel. And sure enough, it was the visitation of Our Lady to Elizabeth in the Judean hill country. At that point, when I sit down, he stuck me in the side with his elbow and said, did you happen to arrange those readings? You know, because he and I both realized these corresponded exactly to the readings that I had been arguing from the night before. But I had always received this sort of, you know, by my own study of Scripture through the filtering of the Fathers. And I leaned over. I was tempted to say, yeah, the Pope calls a convert and he gets to choose the readings. But I said, no, frankly, Bill, I had no idea. This is the first time I've ever gone to the Mass of the Feast of the Assumption of Mary. And you could see he wasn't convinced. He was a little skeptical about that. But I just sat there, quite frankly, marveling at the fact that what had taken me literally years of study to discover, that the Blessed Virgin Mary is the new Eve, who is an instrument of God to bring about the new creation with Jesus, the new Adam, which, by the way, is alluded to in the reading from 1 Corinthians 15 that we'll hear this year for the Feast of the Assumption. You know, but she's not just the new Eve, she's also the Ark of the New Covenant, and thus the instrument of God to help the new Moses, Jesus, her son, bring about a whole new Exodus through the new Passover as the Lamb. But perhaps most spectacularly, she is the Queen Mother of the Son of David, who is not taken up as the Ark was into the earthly capital of the Davidic kingdom, but into the New Jerusalem, the heavenly city. And I think it's just beautiful to recognize that you don't need to have a PhD, you don't need to spend years studying the fathers, you don't need to get involved in all this sort of biblical argumentation with your non-Catholic friends. If you just show up to Mass and you have ears to hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches, you're going to discover how it is the fathers found all of this and how it is that Mother Church communicates it to all of her sons and daughters, even still, 2,000 years after this beautiful mystery of the Assumption of Mary. But I really want to just express my gratitude to our Lord, not only for the spectacular grace conferred upon her, taking her up, as it were, but also the spectacular grace conferred upon us in the Scriptures, through the Church, especially when we read the Bible from the heart of the Church. We're going to see that the fulfillment of the old by Christ in the new wasn't just exclusively reserved for him. It was extended to all of us, especially in and through the Blessed Virgin Mary. So pay close attention to the readings of Sacred Scripture this feast day, and I think you're in for a great banquet.
St. John Damascene says, "It was right that our Blessed Mother, who had kept her virginity unimpaired through the process of giving birth, should have kept her body without decay through death. It was right that she who had given her Creator as a child a place at her breast should be given a place in the dwelling place of her God. It was right that the bride espoused by the Father should dwell in the heavenly bridal chamber. It was right that she who had gazed on her Son on the cross, her heart pierced at that moment by the sword of sorrow that she had escaped at his birth, should now gaze on him seated with his Father. It was right that the Mother of God should possess what belongs to her Son, and to be honored by every creature as God's mother and handmaid. Let us dive deeper into the mystery of the Assumption of Our Lady into heaven. As we pray, Lord, unveil to us the beauty and the greatness of the immaculate soul and body of the Blessed Virgin Mary."
Mary has the most unique relationship with God in history. She is the daughter of God the Father, the mother of God the Son, and the spouse of the Holy Spirit. She was the first disciple in the Church to welcome Jesus into her life, and she always remained close to her Son throughout his life, suffering, death, and resurrection. It is no surprise, then, that the mother whom Jesus loved so dearly chose to take her body and soul into heaven at the end of her earthly life, to share in his glory and live as a royal citizen in the kingdom of heaven. So, to honor our mother in the new order of grace, the Church has always marked the Christian calendar with celebrations that recall the great works God has done for and through Mary by His grace. In 1950, Pope Pius XII infallibly professed that, "We pronounce, declare, and define it to be a divinely revealed dogma that the Immaculate Mother of God, the ever-Virgin Mary, having completed the course of her earthly life, was assumed body and soul to heavenly glory." The Church had always believed this historical truth for 2,000 years, but by confirming the dogma as a matter of faith for all Catholics, the Pope put to rest any doubts and corrected any errors which may have existed in modern times about the doctrine. His teaching was based on the lack of relics of Mary, her empty tomb, symbols of her assumption in Scripture, stories from the early apostolic tradition about the eyewitness of the apostles, quotes from early Christians, and ancient celebrations of the feast day in all churches. Pope Pius made it clear that Mary's assumption was not to be confused with Jesus' ascension into heaven. To ascend is something only God can do by his own divine power. To be assumed is to be taken up by God's power. Keep in mind the wording of the Pope's definition, that she was assumed body and soul into heavenly glory. The Pope was also careful not to indicate that Mary had indeed died before she was assumed, as this is not known for sure and is not important to the fact that she was assumed. In fact, there remains some difference between the Eastern churches and the Western churches as to how exactly it happened. The Eastern churches call Mary's assumption the Dormition of the Mother of God. Dormition is a word for sleep and refers to her death. Many Eastern icons show the apostles mourning over a deceased Mary, with Jesus present, ready to carry her soul first into heaven. Then, according to the tradition, her lifeless body was taken to eternity 3 days later to be reunited with her spirit. The Western Church usually depicts Mary in art being taken alive, body and soul, at once into eternity, but some Western artists also portray her funeral as well. But remember the wording of the Pope's definition, that Mary, having completed the course of her earthly life, this leaves it open to interpretation as to whether she died or not. Some accounts say her assumption may have happened in Ephesus, where she lived for a while with St. John, but many confirm it occurred in Jerusalem. Today, the Church of the Assumption in Jerusalem, a famous place of her possible tomb, still stands as a place of pilgrimage. The Church allows for speculation about the particular details of the story. The fact remains that today we have all of the relics and tombs of every apostle and bones of many early saints, yet no church claims to have the body of Mary, because it isn't on earth. References to the Feast of the Assumption, being celebrated since the time of the apostles, date back to sermons in the 4th century. Today it is considered one of the solemn feast days of the Universal Church. All of the Eastern Orthodox and smaller Eastern churches celebrate the Assumption around this time of year as well, and many of their church buildings are named after the Assumption, especially in Russia. Even many early Protestant reformers also believed in Mary's Assumption, such as Martin Luther, who stated, "There can be no doubt that the Virgin Mary is in heaven. How it happened, we do not know." The Bible tells us that Jesus was the first to enjoy the resurrection. But there are other holy people in Scripture who have not yet experienced the resurrection. Nevertheless, they were given the privilege of being assumed bodily by God. The books of Genesis and Hebrews tells us that Saint Enoch was taken bodily by God. And in 2 Kings chapter 2, the prophet Saint Elijah is said to have been taken bodily into heaven. The letter of Saint Jude also describes how Moses' body was protected from the devil by Saint Michael the Archangel, a story which comes from a book called The Assumption of Moses. Mary's assumption is connected to the fact that she is the new Ark of the Covenant, who was sanctified to carry the Word of God in the flesh. The old Ark carried the Word of God in stone, and no unsanctified man could touch it. In Revelation chapter 11, St. John sees this old Ark in heaven, but immediately following in chapter 12, this image transforms into the figure of a woman with a crown of 12 stars carrying the child Jesus. She is clothed with the sun and stands on the moon, both heavenly symbols. And she escapes the devil in dragon form, to be taken by God to a place where she will dwell in peace. The early church always saw the woman as a symbol of Mary, the new queen mother of the new Israel, who was taken into heaven. The ark was a physical holy vessel which carried the presence of God. Mary was a physical holy vessel who also carried the presence of God. St. John sees both the old ark and the new ark physically in heaven. Psalm 132 foreshadows the fact that both Christ and Mary are in heaven. Arise, O Lord, and come to your resting place, you and the ark of your might.
Mary is the new Eve, who, like the old Eve, was preserved by God's grace from original sin. Unlike the old Eve, Mary always remained obedient to the will of God, and therefore, being sinless, did not undergo the effects of death as a consequence of sin. Jesus and Mary are the two exceptions to the scripture which says, "For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God," which was simply St. Paul's comparison between the faults of the Jews to certain Gentiles. The fact that Mary was so closely united to her son shows us the inseparable bond they shared together on earth, a bond that continues into eternity. What God accomplished for Mary will be done for all the faithful, as we too are promised to be taken up to wear the crown of righteousness and sit on Christ's throne to live and reign with Jesus as children of the Almighty Father in his kingdom. Mary is the best image for the destiny of the Church. Dear friends, although our Blessed Mother is assumed body and soul into heaven, she is still lovingly present close to each one of us, guiding us in our voyage to heaven. And St. Bernard says, when you follow Mary, you will not go astray. When you pray to her, you will not despair. When your mind is on her, you will not wander. When she holds you up, you will not fall. When she protects you, you will have no fear. When she guides you, you will feel no fatigue. And when she is on your side, you will arrive safely home. Dear friends, let us offer this hour in praise of God for all the mercy shown to Mary. Let us thank her who, although assumed into heaven, continues to journey with the Church, sustaining and guiding us, right from her first apparition to Saint James the Apostle in Spain, even to our days, especially in her Basilica at Bandel as Our Lady of Happy Voyage.
As it has arisen from some documents of the 9th century that are conserved in the Cathedral of Zaragoza, Spain, goes back to the immediate subsequent time of the Ascension of Jesus Christ, when the apostles, fortified with the Holy Spirit, went out to preach the gospel. It is said, at that time, around 40 AD, the apostle James the Greater, brother of John and son of Zebedee, preached in Spain. Those lands had not received the gospel, so they were tied to paganism. Saint James, moved by the Holy Spirit, went to the provinces of Spain. Before leaving, he kissed the hands of the Holy Virgin Mary and asked for her blessing, and went forth with the blessing of the Holy Virgin for his mission. She dismissed him with these words, "Go, son, fulfill the mandate of the Master, and by him, I pray that in the city of Spain, in which a greater number of men you will convert to the faith, to build a church in my memory, as I will show you." Leaving Jerusalem, St. James arrived in Spain, and passing through Asturias, came to the city of Oviedo, where he could only baptize one man. Then, entering through Galicia, he preached in the city of Padrón. From there, returning through Castile, he went to Aragon, where Zaragoza is located, on the banks of the Ebro. In this city, after preaching many days, he baptized 8 men, with whom he conversed during the day of the Kingdom of God. At night, alone and disheartened, he walked along the riverbank to rest and pray in silence. During the prayer, one of those nights, he heard voices of angels singing, "Ave Maria, gratia plena." When he heard them, he fell on his knees and saw on the marble pillar the Virgin, who said, "Behold, James, the place where you build a temple in my memory. Look carefully at this pillar in which I am, which my son and master, for you, brought down from above by the hand of the angels, around which you will make the altar of the chapel in this place. The virtue of the Most High will work portents and wonders by my intercession for those who, in their needs, implore my patronage. This pillar will remain in this place until the end of the world, and true Christians will never be lacking in this city." Comforted by this presence of Mary, he built a temple. It is the first church in the world dedicated to the Virgin Mary.
It all started in 1537, when the Portuguese Admiral Sampaio entered the River Hooghly with his fleet of 9 vessels in response to an invitation for help by Sultan Mahmud Shah, the ruler of Bengal. In return, the Portuguese were given permission to establish a factory at Hooghly. About 40 years later, in 1580, a certain Portuguese captain named Trivaris obtained from the Mughal Emperor Akbar the full liberty to preach Christianity publicly and to erect churches. In 1599, a church was built at Bandel.
The very beautiful history of Bandel that it was a church that was destroyed by the Emperor Shahjahan, and how when the miracle of the saving the priest was discovered, how he gave to Bandel 777 beggars of land in that area and helped to the rebuilding the church. And then how suddenly on one day the statue of Our Lady, which was being carried by a soldier across to the Portuguese boat, emerged from the river as the statue had sunk with the soldier. How that statue emerged, and all the residents came to see the statue with a big bright light, and they began to say, Ma Utiche, Ma Utiche. And with that, the statue was put in the place of honor. And that history has been going on for so many years, and many people of all faiths have always been finding grace and favors there.
আজকের ব্যান্ডেল তীর্থক্ষেত্র হয়েছে শুধু খ্রিস্টান নয়, সর্বধর্ম সর্বমানবের এক মিলন ক্ষেত্র। কেউ আসেন দেখতে শুধু দর্শনার্থী হিসাবে, কেউ আসেন প্রার্থনা জানাতে, কেউ আসেন নিজের আকুতি প্রাণের মিনতি মা মারিয়ার চরণ তলে অর্পণ করতে।
Erected in 1599, this Marian shrine of Our Lady of the Most Holy Rosary stands high above the city of Bandel, beckoning pilgrims from far and wide. History is embedded in this ancient pilgrim center. This towering mast of a ship is over 350 years old. This mast was donated by the captain of the ship that was saved from a life-threatening storm in the Bay of Bengal. And this bears the testimony of Marian protection even today to her devotees. Life is a journey, and every journey is a voyage. And every voyage faces rough seas, turbulent weather, gales and storms, ups and downs, and hence every captain desires an assurance of a safe and peaceful journey. Our Lady of Happy Voyage is indeed that assurance which makes a devotee's journey safe and happy. That is why thousands of people keep returning to her every year, some to receive the assurance and some to offer their thanksgiving for having been assured of a happy voyage in life.